for today's program. And so for those of you that are already on, feel free to refresh a beverage and make yourself comfortable, possibly at home, unless we're talking about that, Adams. It was very good at work. And I just got a call from one of our other speakers. They are dialing in now, so we should be ready to go in just a minute or two. A couple of things I always like to remind those that are part of our program, and that is we do record the program. This program will be a little bit different in that we are going to record it as we go along here, and we will be sharing it, obviously, with our attendees and registrants. Probably in a week or so, we will put it up on our YouTube channel. We just want to make sure that those of you that have registered to be part of today get the full value of seeing the program first and having access to it first. We will enable the chat, and so that is open and available now. And so feel free to put any questions you may have there, not only for our partners and moderator, but also obviously all of our speakers and participants. Please leave your phone and your chat and your video or audio, I should say, on mute, just so that we don't get any background noise. I say that because sometimes folks say, I'm really quiet, and then the phone does something. If you're having any audio issues, it could be that because your video is on, it's causing it to lag. And so sometimes we encourage folks that are in residential areas to turn off their video so that you can have a more stable internet. I know sometimes you get that message on Zoom, and we've learned that at times if you turn off the video, you get better access and can hear the audio without any lag. Again, just reminder that the program will kind of follow in three parts. We'll have a beginning where we welcome and recognize some of our partners and sponsors, and then obviously we'll have the introduction of our panelists. Each of them will have a few moments to give some remarks. We've had some prepared questions. And then we'll obviously end with letting you all ask questions and give you sort of some overtime. We usually leave the chat and the Zoom on a little bit after the program ends so that folks can network and connect. Feel free to obviously put your contact information into the chat so that you can connect with folks who are here with us today. And I'll just say as a way of backgrounder, this is, I believe, the 12th year that we have done this program. And I really want to say a special thank you to both Thad Adams, Alan Morris, the Alan Morris Company, because when we put this program together a number of years ago, it really was with their energy and their enthusiasm, as well as their expertise, that we have been able to partner with many great organizations. You hear about one of them today at our friends at the Association of Realtors and the Commercial Alliance. They have been a partner of ours since the beginning. We've worked in the past with such groups as Crew Miami. We've worked with our good friends who work with us in the industrial sector, CIASF. Many of them very connected to Thad and Alan, but most importantly, an extension of our chamber family. So just as a way of understanding that, I want to say thank you to them, especially because they brought this idea to us. We've been able to do this program every year, and a special thank you because we're doing it today for the first time in the virtual space. We're not in a ballroom somewhere having breakfast or a lunch, which we've done over the many years. So hopefully, if Alan hasn't finished his special mix, he might be willing to give us that recipe and we can maybe make that for our next get together. So great to have you. That will be sort of my preamble. I believe all of our speakers have arrived, which is great news. And so with that, I'm going to say again, welcome to all of you. I'm going to recognize our friend Linda Fernandez, who's the chief of communications and their global efforts at the Miami Association of Realtors. And she is joined today by their chief of their commercial arm, Mr. Paul Cauchy, both of whom have worked with us over the last few years and have been great, great partners, not only in these types of programs, but a number of programs that we do throughout the year, and great members of our chamber. So Linda and Paul, thank you very, very much. I know you're gonna hear from Linda in a moment, but I did wanna say a special thank you. Many of you know Alan Morris and the Alan Morris Company. So if you haven't seen the latest issue of Coral Gables magazine, well, I would be remiss if I didn't hold that up here so that you could see that. looking very good. Now, the rumor has it, Alan, that this picture was taken before COVID, which is why you look even more and more dapper here and socially distant from your photographer.
In the old days, when I used to wear go to the office.
Yes, the old days, and when the cameras used to have hoods over them. But this is a great article. I know that for those of you that registered, we actually partnered with Coral Gables Magazine and our great friends there to get you a copy, not only the article, but after today's program, we're going to send each of you a copy of this so that you have it if you haven't already received it, along with our thank you for attending. But this is a great issue, and if you read through it, I think you'll not only be enlightened about some of the things Alan may share today, but the opportunity of what offices and office space will look like going forward. And I know that that will be part of today's program. And just a little bit of background on Alan Morris and his company. They have been in business since April Fool's Day, April 1st, 1958, when founder L. Alan Morris opened shop for the purpose of a brokerage and development of commercial and investment real estate. Those early development projects were single-tenant office buildings, warehouses, and the first regional shopping center was built by their company in 1962. Since then, their impressive portfolio of development projects includes their Florida headquarters for AT&T, multiple district headquarters for Bell South, Florida Power and Light, IBM, Unisys, International Harvester, General Motors Acceptance Corporation, Florida Gas Company, U.S. Steel, Belcher Oil Company, Lockheed Martin, Sears, Bank of America International, CBS, and of course, our very own Federal Reserve Bank of Miami out in Doral. Their legacy of success is due to their unwavering commitment to placing the client's needs first, guaranteeing satisfaction, and delivering what they promise every single time. So, Alan, thank you very much. We have a special relationship with you, not only in a longtime chamber relationship, but currently where I am sitting, you are the owner of this beautiful building, and we are proud to be one of your tenants. I also get to introduce NRI, Nolan Reynolds International. NRI's history dates back to 1890 and includes the completion of more than $2.5 billion of construction and many large-scale government infrastructure and private mixed-use projects. This record of success provides their team a level of experience that few can match. Their history demonstrates that they will exceed their clients' expectations with a team that can manage all aspects of a project from feasibility to financing and from construction to asset management. And they are about to deliver an incredible project right here along US 1 in the City Beautiful that is known as Paseo de la Riviera, while working on another project that is deep into construction along US 1 as well, just a little further north and in just short order. I'm very excited that you will be hearing from them about the opening of the Thesis Hotel later this summer, very, very early fall. So I know Brent and Alan are both going to be on the panel, but I'd love to give them a chance to say hello before I introduce Linda. So maybe, Alan, a quick hello from you.
Great. It's great to be here with everybody this morning, talking about our favorite subject, which is real estate. And I'm particularly grateful for Mark Trowbridge and what an extraordinary Chamber of Commerce we are fortunate to have in Coral Gables. It's not usual that we get to have a community with such a strong, vibrant chamber with such great leadership as we have in Coral Gables. And you really begin to appreciate that sort of thing in a down market and times of uncertainty like we have right now. And this is when the chamber really earns its stripes by keeping us all together and keeping us connected and providing these great resources for us. So thank you so much, Mark.
Alan, thank you very much. And we are able to do what we do with great partners like you. And of course, our friend Brent Reynolds. And I want to open the microphone and say welcome to Brent Reynolds from NRI. Brent? You might be on mute, Brent.
You're right. I was on mute. I apologize. Thank you, Mark.
Brent, you're lagging a little bit on us. So let me just interrupt you because I don't want you to.
We pride ourselves for constant learner, so I'm excited to learn from the others in the industry of what the outlook is going to be.
All right, Brent, so I'm going to maybe ask you to dial back in because you're lagging quite heavily. I see that you're in your car, but I don't think anybody can hear you. All right, so Eric, if you can reach out to Brent and see if he can dial back in because we'll want to make sure he has a stronger connection when we get back to the program. It's now my pleasure to introduce our wonderful partners from the Miami Association of Realtors and their Commercial Real Estate Alliance. They have been great advocates, not only of the real estate community here in South Florida, but they are the largest association in the world. And I think if you know their leadership team and Teresa Kinkinney and of course Linda Fernandez, Paul Cauchy, and the entire crew, you understand why that is. And we're very fortunate that every time we reach out to them and ask them to work with us, they give us a big thumbs up, and that's how we are here today. So please welcome our friend and great partner, Linda Fernandez.
Thank you so much, Mark. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Miami Association of Realtors, our CEO, Teresa Kinkinney, and our chairman of the board, George Guerra, Paul Cauchy, and I would like to thank Mark, Erica, and the leadership at Coral Gables Chamber of Commerce for hosting this event. As Mark mentioned, we partner on several events, and we have been doing so for many years, and we greatly value and appreciate our partnership and collaboration. Thank you also to the panelists and attendees. And it is now my pleasure to introduce our moderator, Jennifer Woolman. Jennifer Woolman has been a realtor for over 20 years and is an associate with Berkshire Hathaway Home Services EWM Realty, a company with deep roots and headquartered here in Coral Gables. Jennifer is the 2019 Chairman of the Board and Commercial President, and 2020 Chairman-Elect of the Miami Realtors. So she will be our Chairman next year in 2021. The largest local realtor association in the U.S. With more than 50,000 members and over 220 agreements with international partner associations. Jennifer is also a member of Miami-Dade's COVID-19 Economic Recovery Task Force. She graduated from the University of San Francisco and has a strong and vast background in business and environmental management. She's also a great travel partner. Welcome, Jennifer.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. We are so lucky. I know we've been attending a lot of Zoom meetings on COVID, and I'm excited that this one has to do with a more forward-looking discussion of how we come out of this global pandemic. And our three panelists have great diverse backgrounds. So we've got Alan Morris, who's obviously been a staple in Coral Gables commercial real estate for decades. And then we've got Brent and his company, who are more recent newcomers, but came in with a bang with their two beautiful projects. And then Julian, who's a native or who's been around for a long time, but just started with the city in December. So he really had to hit the ground running. He'd only been on about 3 months when all of this hit. So let me get started introducing Alan Morris. He's chairman and CEO of the Alan Morris Company. He's a licensed real estate broker, mortgage broker, and holds the professional designations of CPM, which is the Certified Property Manager of the Institute of Real Estate Management, and SIOR from the Society of Industrial and Office Realtors. He is past president of the Florida CCIM chapter, which is for the Certified Commercial Investment Member of the Realtors National Marketing Institute. And he also holds the prestigious CRE designation, which is the Council of Realty, and FRICS as a Fellow of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors. For those of you who don't know, he is also a wonderfully insightful writer, and I encourage you to read his blog. I did confess to him today that I am a kind of one of his blog stalkers. I love reading his blog. It's very inspirational. Brent Reynolds is CEO and managing partner of Nolan Reynolds International. He is primarily responsible for the firm's strategic growth and development activities within the United States and throughout Latin America. Brent identifies and creates opportunities that are aligned with the company's strategic plan of acquiring, financing, planning, permitting, and developing high-value projects. His exposure to a wide variety of project types, as well as various kinds of regulatory obstacles, make him adept at integrating the company's operations into new markets quickly and efficiently. Brent brought the talent and expertise of an established U.S. corporation to capitalize on an emerging market opportunity through the acquisition, capital funding, and entitlement of a $75 million mixed-use project in Costa Rica, which further developed into the creation of a resort luxury hotel brand. And his two projects on US one also incorporate hotels in some very exciting spaces that we'll be discussing. Julian Perez is the Director of Economic and Development Department of the City of Coral Gables. He is an economic development manager and urban planner with extensive project management and development experience in the private and public sectors. He served several municipalities, including the city of Doral, the town of Cutler Bay, village of Palmetto Bay, and the city of South Miami. In Miami-Dade County as a department director, his responsibilities included implementation of economic development programs, comprehensive plans, land development regulations, and review of land development projects, interpretation of zoning and land use. And as I mentioned, he had just started. He'd only been with the city for about 3 months when everything hit the fan. So ladies and gentlemen, I welcome our panelists. So to begin, I just want to get a quick overview of where the state of the market was before COVID. Everything was going great. We're in one of the longest expansions, economic expansions in history. And overall, the economy was on a roll, and specifically Coral Gables was especially strong. So, Alan, can you tell me, since this is about rebounding, this discussion, give me a little bit of insight where we were, how this pandemic affected you, the immediate effect, and a little bit of your sights moving forward.
Great, thank you. I believe that having gone through a number of cycles like this, of course, there's never been in our lifetime a cycle quite like this. Each one is different. This one is unique and it's dramatic. We found ourselves in 2019, the beginning of 2020, expanding very aggressively and clearly with the advent of COVID, we, like most everyone else, has put the brakes on launching new projects. We have four projects that are under construction right now today that are in different locations in Orlando and in Atlanta. And all of them have proceeded with very minor delays, which is really interesting, but with good work with the contractors and subcontractors, created COVID security and protocols. And we are opening a new apartment building in Orlando, a new apartment building in Atlanta, the end of this month. In the midst of all of this, it's really interesting to see that that people are continuing to lease apartments and do so sometimes without ever going to the site. Well, they'll take an online tour. They'll ask questions online on a Zoom meeting and a presentation and sign their lease remotely. Most come to the property for a quick visit before they sign their lease. But other than that, the sales pitch is all online. Very interesting to see. It's teaching this old dog some new tricks to see how that can work.
That's good news for the economy moving forward, right? That people are still getting on with their lives.
It is. I didn't know what to expect would happen this month. We're doing our pre-leasing this month, and we are watching pre-leasing ramp up more and more each week over the course of the past month. I just got updated reports this morning, and it's very positive, very encouraging. One of the hard points, one of the disappointments, and it's one of the things that affects us in Coral Gables and around Miami also, is that the University of Central Florida is having most of their classes online. So students that we're gonna locate in our new apartment building next to the downtown campus of UCF called Creative Village, don't need to move next to the campus because they're gonna be doing their fall classes online. But we found that non-students are the ones renting our apartments now. So
that's great. That's at least you're getting residents in there. Brent, you also have two projects, the on US 1, Paseo de la Riviera, I believe is the one that's closer to being done with the beautiful Thesis Hotel. And I believe you were also catering a bit to the UM community. Can you tell us a little bit about how you were doing pre-COVID, what happened, how you guys kind of shifted when this all happened and where you stand now?
Sure, you know, not too dissimilar to Alan, we started pre-leasing the Paseo project actually when I would say the crux of the pandemic really came upon us. So we started that in March, and we saw, I would call it fair market activity. It was a little bit slow, but as we progressed over those months, we've actually seen a pickup in activity. To the point where we are today, we're over 60% pre-leased. We have seen a mix of students and younger families and people relocating. And we spend a lot of time communicating with those potential tenants, making sure that their concerns are alleviated or their questions are answered. And we found that although Florida is in an epicenter at the moment, there are is still a lot of desire to come into this market. A lot of our residents are actually not local. And I would offer that as both the student population and the non-student population. So it's interesting to find their desire to live here, even though we're going through some of these struggles at the moment. So we continue to pre-lease. And we continue to maintain the rate that we've anticipated. So like Alan mentioned, for us, it's good news. It's still an indicator that the market is strong and there's still a desire for the quality product.
Great. We're gonna get into some of those, the qualities of your product in a little bit when we go to the next part. But for now, Julian, economic development is one of your main roles. How do you think that's shifted, especially with keeping and bringing businesses to the city in the middle of a pandemic?
I can tell you that before the pandemic, we were enjoying a very successful economic development effort here in the city of Coral Gables. If you look back and you look at the occupancy rate for retail was about 95% citywide, as well as the office was about 92%. So we were doing very well. Another thing that we were looking at was the benefits that a lot of communities, especially in South Florida, were deriving from the 2017 Tax Cut and Jobs Act. We were looking at some of the companies from the Northeast, especially in the wealth management, relocating to South Florida because of, obviously, as you know, a lot of the benefits that were no longer available up in the Northeast were now, you know, those benefits were found down here in South Florida, in the state of Florida, tax-friendly state. So, you know, we were planning to really build on that and continue to expand our economic success, you know, based on attracting a lot of those companies and so forth. And obviously working with our partners, the chamber, as well as the bid and so forth. Boom. From day to night, we have not a disaster, but we have a crisis in our hands, all right? And we needed to right away begin to understand that crisis and begin to put together a plan to sure that we were not only addressing the short term, which was the crisis management, but we were also preparing for the intermediate and the long term, which was managing the second leg of the crisis, which was the economic impact. And how we were going to transition from a health crisis management to an economic response to eventually the third leg, which is a mental aspect of this, unfortunately. So what we did was right away, we began to work with our partners, the BID, and as well as the chamber, in beginning to kind of scope the first phase or the first tier of a two-tier program that we put in place. And that was, you know, the communication and so forth, the cooperation and making sure that people were calm, that we were thinking strategically and methodical as we went through the process, as we developed the plan. And to make sure that at the same time, we were not forgetting our mission, that we knew that even in the middle of all of this turmoil and all those changes that were taking place, that eventually we were going to get to a period where people were going to look again at the market, especially in Coral Gables, and like it's been well presented by Mr. Allen and Mr. Reynolds, and make sure that we still had that infrastructure in place to help accommodate those potential new businesses that may be looking at the city of Coral Gables. And so actually, I think that in answer to your questions, I think it was recognizing that it was a crisis and not a disaster, and making sure that we put all of the mechanism in place to be able not only to address the crisis that we're doing, okay, but also maintain our focus on our goal.
So let's talk about some of those changes. Each of you are visionaries who brought innovative ideas to the buildings and cities that you led before the pandemic. And I want to discuss a little bit how those innovations are going to assist with our local recovery and with the cities continuing to bring businesses and residents to the City Beautiful. And so let me start with Brent. Both Gable Station and Paseo de la Riviera incorporate large open communal spaces, whether it's the 68,000 square foot Lifetime gym in the Gable Station or the amazing amount of park space incorporated in both projects with your urban living room concept, and then the tie-in in Gable Station with the Underline, which I know you're really involved in. Please talk a little bit about the urban living room and how you think that open spaces and the Underline are gonna combine to deal with some of the new behaviors of social distancing, healthy lifestyle, et cetera, that might be long-term changes from COVID.
Sure. So in talking more specifically about Paseo, we created a central nucleus, if you will, that would not only serve as an amenity for the residents and the consumers within our project, but it would bring the outside community in. So it was a focal point of the project at which we evolved the rest of the elements from. As COVID has evolved and this new way of living is anticipated to become the new norm, we've looked at our projects and we've seen how we can incorporate all of our outdoor spaces into each component. So the Paseo project has an internal centralized courtyard that is lined by our food and beverage outlets and other office retail components that is all focused on that outdoor space. But what we have found in design that we'd like to say we were forward thinking, but really it's only happened as an evolution, is we have that outdoor space that is connected by what we would call a grand staircase that's open air. I think one of the things that has become a focal point is how the consumer is going to traverse through these buildings. What is a safe environment for people to get from one floor to the next? And these larger gathering areas, and how do we move that consumer? So we are hyper-focused on that external staircase that connects our upper outdoor dining and pool and amenity decks to the centralized interior courtyard that further connects out to the community at large. So we're trying to maintain those elements that naturally allow for the spatial distancing and for, as I said, the outdoor components of it. Another thing that we're focusing on is from an operations standpoint. For us, more than the physical elements of the building, it's the operations. How are you going to operate your facility in a safe environment? How is your consumer going to feel comfortable? How are you going to keep not only your employees safe, but that of the end user? So what we've been focused on is items and elements that will be truly effective on an ongoing basis. We recently hired a chief medical advisor to our board to really analyze and provide guidance on all of our operational decisions, whether it's the systems we implement, the cleaning processes, or just really the interaction. He sits on our board, reviews all of our programming, and provides feedback. So it's actually an effective. Dr. Prendergast is a longstanding doctor from the Mayo Clinic, part of the Infectious Disease Institute, not only nationally, but on a global scale. So the wealth of knowledge that he's brought to us, and we have since incorporated into all of our properties, I think gives a bit of a competitive edge to the longevity of these practices. So we're testing, we're analyzing, and then we're implementing and incorporating that into our open air. Going back to the physical structures, I think we're fortunate enough to have had a vision to really focus on these outdoor spaces and incorporating it into our projects and larger spaces so people can naturally spread out. And it's something that we're getting a lot of positive feedback. On our residential project at Paseo, we really have two amenity decks. We have the large pool social amenity deck, what I'm calling on the back side of the building, which is the south side, facing towards the bay and downtown. And then we've also incorporated interior courtyard, and we've elongated that through our design process, and we've created pockets that people can, in either related groups or trusted groups, socialize in a safe manner and provide a natural barrier between parallel groups in what I would call the next pod over. So that interior courtyard has three pods that are small by nature, but allows different groups to find different areas of the project to socialize in a safe manner. I think it's important to realize that we are creatures of interaction, and it's important that we can provide that social element, but also provide that element of isolation.
So Alan, that social element has gone digital, and your Alhambra Towers was the first building in Coral Gables and the second of in all of Florida to earn the Platinum Wired certification, which again seems super visionary now when everybody's gone to Zoom meetings and virtual for just about everything. Yes. Tell us a bit about the technology that was added to the building and the feedback you've gotten from current tenants on how it's helped them adapt more rapidly.
Well, I think the idea of having a serious focus on connectivity in this generation, this next generation of office buildings and multifamily apartment buildings in all commercial buildings is going to become more and more and more important as we are experiencing it right now. You know, you're either in business or you're out of business right now, based on whether you've got connectivity. Actually, because of the high-speed fiber optic connectivity that we designed into Alhambra Towers from the beginning, we were able to, when we were able to be sure that all of our employees could work from home and all had proper connectivity and proper setups working through our central core, in Alhambra Towers before we actually had to isolate. So when we had to isolate, it was just like flipping a switch. Everybody was back in their apartments or their homes, and we had like 8 different meetings set up every week with our different teams. And sometimes I have 4 or 5 meetings a day on Zoom, like a lot of us do. And I think the things that Brent was talking about, were the outdoor living room area, is a great example of a great design for this era, for this new post-COVID world. We, for instance, designed a big open plaza in front of Alhambra Towers as a dining plaza, and we have restaurants that are now fighting over it to get that space, to have open air space for our residents in the building, our tenants in the building. And we're in a new building that we're designing that we'll be able to announce next month. It goes to DRC July 31st. We'll be unveiling our new Ponce Park residences, which is going to be designed with a lot of these same features in mind. And that is oversized balconies for every apartment. A little bit larger interior space as well for every apartment, so that you can have either, you know, a piece of workout equipment or an office den in the apartment to allow people to have the freedom to work from home more, even if they're not working from home full time, to have that flexibility, because a large percentage of people want to be able to work from home in the future part-time, if not full-time. Most people want to get back into the office, but also many people want to be able to have the flexibility to work part of the time from their home when it's convenient to do so. And we're designing that into our new generation apartments that we'll unveil next month.
Julian, both of both Alan and Brent talked about open spaces, which Coral Gables is super mm-hmm. well known for. When you came on board, the city had just finished some major development projects on Miracle Mile and Giralda Plaza, which both did this. Can you please give me some idea on what the city's doing to help individuals and companies adapt to some of this new behavior, especially given the live, work, play nature of Coral Gables?
One of the things that we started doing before the pandemic was to look at our land development code to make sure that our land development code was up to speed with a lot of these new projects, new concepts that were being introduced. That's number one. Number two, as we move forward, I know that we're going to be putting special attention to the integration. How do we integrate all of these projects into the existing infrastructure that we have? And specifically when it comes to the smart city technology and all the work that we have done in that area, you know, we're nationally known for our smart city technology and programs that we have implemented. And that's also is going to play a tremendous role because you have very nice state-of-the-art development like we just mentioned, but you want to make sure that they all get integrated as part of the city and as part of the technology that that we are constantly introducing to improve not only the lives of our citizens, but also you know, the way that we do business and making it more effective.
So this is to all three of you. So Coral Gables is also known for their support of the art projects, such as the Umbrella Sky Art Project that you had last year, as well as the Illuminating Coral Gables installation that's going to be happening in January. Until people feel comfortable congregating in close groups again, how do you continue having those events? And Brent, I know you have a lot in your buildings, you have a lot of event space. How do you have those events with a mix between virtual and personal to give people that sense of security? Because right now I think everything is just people need to feel safe, right? It was like after 9/11 to get people traveling again, we had to make people feel safe. The same thing here, you have to make people feel safe getting together in groups. How can you use technology to do both while still providing a personal experience? Let's start with Julian with the art project.
Yes, I would say that obviously we'll continue to move forward with some projects, and obviously we'll be respecting all the social distancing, no congregations, and all that. But we had, you know, a number of projects, you know, art projects. We had a very successful program with the University of Miami, the music department, where there was a series of concerts. I think they were on Friday, and that was very, very successful. The point here is really begin to look at those opportunities from an art perspective that we can do as a city that will not put people in harm's way. So yes, Illuminate, we're gonna probably be doing in a very small scale, and hopefully when this crisis passes, you know, we'll be able to go back to the normal. But I think that the most important thing is to stay focused again, you know, and continue with the program that we have, but identifying projects of probably a smaller scale, you know, to keep the art and to make sure that the art is also part of the economic development process, you know, also. Again, the most important thing is we want to make sure that people feel comfortable and that even though we're going through the different phases of this crisis, that they know that there's going to be a light at the end of the tunnel. And obviously art is one of those things that that help us through it. So we're going to see from the city is probably you're going to see more specific and small events having to do with the arts. And obviously working with our partners and also working with members of you know, the development community and so forth. Again, all of this has to be a major, you know, cooperation among all of the stakeholders that are part of this process, and they're all part of the city.
Mm-hmm. Brent or Alan?
Sure. I mean, for us, the easy answer is you reduce the size of those events and or utilize the outdoor space. But I think one of the things that we have focused on is playing into what people are already comfortable with. So it's reducing the time period by which somebody has to commit to the space. We're seeing a lot of bookings for the hotel as short as 72 hours, but primarily in the week for the week. People were booking out group business and hospitality, transient business, anywhere from 30 to 90 days out. Now that time period has. So I'm gonna wait, I'm gonna find out if I'm comfortable, and then make my decision. So we're accommodating that change in behavior. But another thing that we are really starting to do is focus on sectors that together feel safe. So it's small corporations or small businesses that are already interacting, have gone back to work and are socializing, allowing them to have a different venue for opportunity for business, small family gatherings, small weddings, what have you. So groups that are already socializing together, that already feel comfortable together, utilizing those opportunities for the indoor space, the larger event space, or larger events, if you will, are more focused on the outdoor space. One of the other things that we've discussed is even with the higher education institutions in and around Coral Gables is utilizing the conference space, setting it up with the appropriate physical distancing and bringing in the technology that allows a small group to be live and the rest of the group to be virtual and then flip-flopping it. So putting it on a schedule. But what that does is makes us commit to not necessarily one day of meetings, but 2 days of meetings or 3 days of meetings and working with them on their budgetary constraints. So it definitely has impacts and creates restructuring, but there is opportunity out there to accommodate and make people feel safe in the current market conditions.
Yeah.
Alan?
Those are great comments. And I think that the one of the things that we're also doing in terms of creating gathering spaces and open air spaces for social distancing is in our new project, Ponce Park Residences, that will be across the street from the Ponce Circle Park at the corner of Ponce de Leon and University Drive. We're going to be creating a 16,000 square foot public park with fountains and seating areas and dramatic landscaping. And next to it will be very high ceiling and deep open plazas within the base of the building for separated open air outdoor dining, but under the cover of a 22 foot high ceiling with giant arches in it. It'll be something artistically like nobody has seen in Coral Gables before. What we're basically doing is, in the same way we did something a little outrageous with Alhambra Towers for the office market, we're doing something a little outrageous that no one has seen architecturally in a new kind of Mediterranean architecture for Ponce Park Towers. I think people will like it, and I think it'll be enlivening to people to see a new kind of exciting architecture with very dramatic arches and open air plazas undercover, and then connecting to an open air park.
And now for our final segment, I want to give some kudos to Coral Gables magazine, just like Mark did. I didn't get to read your interview or your piece, Alan. I hadn't seen it yet. But for the next section, I'm going to do a full disclaimer on Brent and on Julian. I did pull some information about you from the Coral Gables magazine. So Julian, in a February interview with the magazine, you said, "You have to always look at the future, because cities are constantly changing. Just like humans, cities have a life cycle, and you always have to make sure that whatever you are doing, you are preparing the city for the next step. What are some of the bigger next steps that the City of Coral Gables is taking?"
I think that the one of the major steps that we're taking is making sure that we stay on top of the technology, the information technology. And that's what's going to make the city successful in the future. It's going to make the business successful, and it's going to attract, the type of businesses that really fit well with the culture of the city. And by having that technology in place and always expanding on that technology, I think will be a tremendous, tremendous benefit, not only to the City of Coral Gables, but I think to Miami-Dade County, as well as the region. Remember that we're a small economy in a big regional economy, and how well we move as a city would also be reflected in our neighbors and as well as our regional partners. So we wanted to make sure that we're at the forefront when it comes to technology, and that we're using technology appropriately, and always thinking of how that technology can always be improved. And that's what, I really meant when I said that cities are like humans. It's just that we're biological, and they change. And you can see it in the old neighborhoods, like they transition into new families coming in and so forth, and then they take a very different look. You can have an area that is lacking some economic activity, but if you find the right development and you put that development in that location, then you give life to that community, but most important, or that neighborhood, but most important, you give life and new life to the community and the city, so the city evolves. So one of the major tools that we're constantly working on is technology, and making sure that we're smart from a technology perspective, and we're also applying the basic principle of smart growth, and that we're sustainable and resilient. And in closing, that is one of the things that this reopening plan is working towards too. In this reopening plan that we have adopted, one of the areas that we look at from a technical assistance to our business community is the technology part. How can we make our businesses more resilient from a technology perspective? And we have already started doing that with a series of seminars with our partners from Silicon Valley's, our partners at the University of Miami, and also the technological partners. And out of that first technical assistant webinar that we had, an internship program came out of the University of Miami that is going to have students that are going to be working directly with some of our small businesses that, you know, lack the expertise in certain technologies so that we can bring them up to speed and make them more resilient for the next wave or any other disaster or crisis that we see in the future.
As we come out of this crisis, Alan and Brent, what are some of the lessons that you take away as a company and as an individual? And if you can just make really quick answers, because we're running a little short on time, but what did you learn from this and what do you take forward?
Quick points I can give to you. One, when you find yourself in a crisis, accept what is. Stay open to just see it for what it is without panicking. Secondly, to act on what you know. And not to panic, but to act on what you can see makes sense as the next possible step. Assume a reasonable future. Like we're assuming that there'll be a vaccine within the next 4 to 12 months. Okay, if there is, then let's assume that is a reasonable thing. And assume it's going to take a while for the economy to ramp back up. So it won't be like flipping a light switch back on, but it'll take a little while. But everybody is universally motivated to expanding this economy again. And fourthly, to expect opportunities. Look for the opportunities. Like I was in New Orleans to buy a hotel yesterday. I'm looking for opportunities. Think during 2008 and 2009, I was looking for properties to buy. And one of the properties I bought was the key property that we're now developing beginning next month in Coral Gables because of the recession of 2008. And fifthly, just have faith. Have faith in what you don't see yet because we're in a really great place. We get to live in Miami. We get to live in Coral Gables of all things. Who gets to live in Coral Gables? This is like one of the most beautiful places in all of the world in the United States of America, and we are blessed. So those are my five thoughts.
Thank you, Brent.
I'll share two thoughts. I think from our perspective, as we've evolved as an organization and more importantly during COVID, adaptability. You need to be adaptable in the way that you operate, and you need to be adaptable in the way that you design. For example, the reason I'm in a car, I'm actually up at the Culinary Institute of America. We're designing a resort in partnership with them, and I'm modifying the design to ideas that I think are going to become the new norm. So we're incorporating a grand stair. Again, how do we traverse people through this product in a safe manner? So we're doing a grand stair that's taking you up to the spa and the outdoor observatory deck and whatnot versus having to go in an elevator. It's something that we didn't think about before, but we're incorporating into our design now. Adaptability in our operations, you know, as the market was increasingly improving pre-COVID, everybody was riding the wave. They were following the market trends. They were just basically reaching out to the typical venues by which they would market and promote their project. That didn't work during COVID, and as we see post-COVID or as COVID continues to evolve, we had to take a more organic boots on the ground approach to keep our hotel assets open and operational, and we were able to exceed our market share of the competition by doing that. So we adapted our operational strategy. So adaptability is a key component and is going to be at the forefront of our thinking as we continue to evolve. And then second for us is data. I used to follow the data, but I would basically go from intuition to say, this is what we want to do. We believe this is a good design, a good idea, and we'll evolve on that. I think data is going to be even more important as we go forward to be able to understand how consumer trends and how the market and how the product and technology will evolve and behaviors will evolve. and geo-tracking is one of the things that we've been incorporating into some of our new projects. So data is going to be key to make good long-term decisions. So those are two elements that we've really honed in on as the COVID pandemic has evolved.
Great, thank you so much. Before I turn it over to Mark for questions, at the beginning I confessed that I was a stalker of Alan's blog. So I want to leave you with a quote from his May 29th blog. Quote, "Our business and our economy are entirely based on faith. Faith in the future, faith in one another to fulfill our agreements, and faith in our government to promote justice and safety." So I want everybody to have a little bit of faith that we will get through this. There is a light at the end of the tunnel, and there are much better days to come, but there are lessons to be learned today. Mark.
Jennifer, thank you very much. I think that's a perfect segue to a couple of the questions that have come in the chat, but I also want to thank you for your wonderful moderation skills, the homework that you've done, and congratulate you on your new role with the association. I know that's going to be a great opportunity. And of course, the Chamber has been longtime partners with our good friends at Berkshire Hathaway Home Services, EWM. So thank you very, very much. Well, let's pick up on that optimism piece and the question for both Alan and Brent on the development side, and then Julian in the bigger picture, is how do you maintain that optimism? How do you look into the future and still see that upside? Because in many cases, you've invested not only tremendous amounts of money, but energy, vision, and time. Where does that optimism come from? Alan?
Well, I would say that as I look back on the best real estate decisions that I made, best business decisions, best investment decisions, some of the best ones were made when I was really scared because nobody else was doing what I was doing. And I kept asking myself, have I lost my mind? Am I crazy to be doing this right now? Because nobody else is doing this. And, you know, I remember back in 2008, when I, you know, bought land in downtown Coral Gables. Nobody was buying land in downtown Coral Gables. And went back in the previous recession in 1994 and 95, it was like everybody knew the worst investment of the world was office buildings. So nobody was buying office buildings. And when people are saying that, that's when I say, wow, maybe it's time to start buying office buildings. And so when we began to feel companies start to come back and making inquiries about wanting to tour space, we quickly bought a 100% vacant office building in Orlando and a largely vacant office building in Jacksonville. And both of those, well, the Jacksonville building we have, you know, we're closing the end of this month for $9.9 million, and we bought it for $1.9 million. So, you know, the best decisions you make, the greatest opportunities come in crazy markets like this, when there is a dramatic downturn, there's a crisis, and everybody's scared and everybody's terrified and everybody's pulling back. And so that can also be the time to carefully and prudently go out and invest.
Awesome. I wanted you to know that I was looking at Brent's reaction when you talked about making those decisions with being scared, and I could just tell he sort of had an identification with that. He sort of put his head back. Brent, your thoughts?
No, I couldn't agree more. Some of the best decisions come out of times like this. However, from our perspective, we look at this, you know, a lot of people are saying the fundamentals in the markets are not there. However, the fundamentals always remain in real estate. It's hard to deviate from that. And we stay focused on the fundamentals that guide us through. And one of those is a long-term outlook. We're not looking to build and sell. We're looking to hold our assets long-term. And if we're able to stay disciplined and focused and patient, the market will recover. There might be challenges that we face short term, but it will recover. And if you buy right, you know, to Alan's example, where he bought a building for $1 million and selling it for $9 million, if you buy right, build right, and you do that in the right locations, theoretically, your real estate will perform. It might not perform in your original time frame, but it will perform. So we stay disciplined to our long-term outlook and the assets that we buy. It's easy for you to go and quickly buy distressed assets outside of your core discipline. We try not to do that and stay focused on what we know well and where we feel comfortable.
Thank you, Brent. And some of you asked for where you could find Alan's blog. Amy put that into the chat, alanmorris.com/and now the good news. That's all hyphenated. Julian, any thoughts on your end in terms of maintaining that optimism? I can tell from working with you over the last 7 or 8 months, and you came in to a big job and immediately had to pivot to helping us thrive through a pandemic, that you always maintain a sense of, here's what the reality is, but here's what we can be doing, and here's where we can be looking. How do you maintain that level of optimism when the weight of the world is oftentimes upon the shoulders of the city?
Mark, I think you summarized it. I think, first of all, is understanding the crisis is the most important thing, and to know what you're dealing with. Number two is making sure that we think strategically and that we stay methodical, we stay focused. And then third is to make sure that you're working with a very effective team that is willing to listen to you, that sees the value of thinking strategically. And I have had the pleasure of working with you all these months, hand by hand, as well as with a bid, and obviously the team that we have here in the city, led by the manager, Mr. Peter Iglesias, as well as Chief De La Rosa, and the elected body. We have always been very, very focused as to the things that we have to do to make sure that we keep our city, our residents, and our business community healthy, and understand that, you know, we're dealing with a crisis. We're not dealing with a disaster, and that, you know, we have to stay very optimistic, and we really, wherever there is a deficiency, we need to zero in on that deficiency, to bring those folks back up, and again, make them more sustainable and more resilient. And that's basically my job. You know, some people say, you're not excited. I said, no, I can't be excited. I have to be very strategically with my thinking, and I have to make sure that everybody around me is calm and collect. And that's the only way we're gonna get over this.
Thank you, Julian. A question back to you, Brent, came from Luciana, who just asked a little bit more about the plan in terms of the opening of the thesis and the project with Gable Station. Anything you want to share there? Obviously, things are a little day-to-day, specifically with the hotel, but I know that we've been in contact with your team. Anything you want to share? You were a little choppy at the very beginning, so this may be an opportunity to share a little bit more about both of your projects.
Sure. Paseo, we're planning to open that project mid-August. We're going to slowly open the hotel as reservations come in and probably have a more formal grand opening, so to speak, in September. As you mentioned, it is a little bit up in the air at the moment. We want to make sure that we have the larger, grander opportunity at a time where people feel comfortable come and enjoy both the food and beverage outlets that we have. We have two prime food and beverage outlets being run by Chef Niven, James Beard Award-winning finalist. And the hotel is scheduled to take first reservations, as I said, mid-August. But again, a more grand opening in September. The residential side is starting to open currently. We're starting to take move-ins as we speak, and we'll continue to do so through July, August, and September.
Fantastic. And I know people are going to be very excited about the food and beverage. They may not realize and recognize him by his name, but he is a visionary. here in the community with some of his other restaurants as well. But I think it's going to be awesome.
That's been one of the most challenging things during COVID is doing all the taste testing and trying not to indulge in those times.
Really? Are you talking more about just, you know, being able to slide into those size 32 chinos? The last question I have for all of our panelists is just, Coral Gables is known, as Jennifer mentioned, for many of our wonderful, amazing assets. But if there's one thing that you could put your finger on when you think of Coral Gables, or when you're selling it to a tenant or a prospective guest, or, you know, a new company, what is that one thing? Why don't we start with you, Alan?
Well, I think it's more a combination of things, but if I was to pick one thing, I would say architecture. I just love the thoughtful architecture. We've gone through eras in Coral Gables where the architecture was not great. Yeah. And I love seeing forward-thinking developers that are willing to risk the additional investment of great architecture, because as it says in the textbook, The History of Art, the very first art was architecture. And I think that's still the greatest art. You know, it's much easier to be a doctor where you can bury your mistakes. But as a developer, people will see your mistakes for generations if you do it wrong.
You're right.
What about you, Brent? Thank you, Alan. That was great.
If I were to put one word into it, I would say that I would use the word evolution. It's very rare that you see communities with such a long-standing rich history evolve into a dynamic, new and exciting and modern location with while maintaining that rich history. Typically in smaller cities, you see an evolution and they do one of two things. They lose their history or they miss an opportunity to capture the current state of mind. I think Coral Gables, through their process, has done a great job in being able to not only embrace their history, but allow themselves to modernize.
Perfect. And Julian, how about a final thought, my friend?
My final thought is when I look at the city beautiful, I look at a city that is very progressive, a city that looks at technology as we move on into, you know, the future. And that makes it very, very excited place to be and to work.
Can I chime in? My word would be connectivity.
Yes. Oh, my say word. That again, Jennifer. I stepped on you, please.
It would be connectivity. And I don't mean it just in terms of transportation, which is definitely true, but in terms of community. I feel like Coral Gables is a connected community, whether it's residents to their businesses, the transportation aspect now coming with the underline and the connectivity of space. So I think Coral Gables has done a really job of bringing all those different aspects together and having them connect like a beautiful puzzle piece.
Well, that's the perfect place for us to end. I want to invite you all to open up your calendars. Just a couple things I want to remind you. Next Tuesday, the 28th, we'll be joined by Will Dukes of Sales Partners Florida, 10 a.m. for a Chamber 201. We will have, of course, our Reconnect virtual luncheon at noon on August 5th, followed by a Wind Down Wednesday later that evening, virtual networker at 5 p.m. And please save the date for our annual conference. Come together August 27th and 28th, presented by Florida Blue. Very excited with what we have planned and are already planning. And many thanks to Brian Barakat. I hope you all like the theme. It both has both visual aspects. For those of us that are Beatles fans, it has musical aspects. And of course, the reality that once again, we will come together. We're going to leave the Zoom on for a little overtime, but how about another round of applause? And many, many thanks to Alan Morris, to Brent Reynolds, to Julian Perez, and to our great moderator, Jennifer Woolman. Thank you so much to our wonderful partners and sponsors at the Association of Realtors, NRI, and of course, the Alan Morris Company. We are truly, truly blessed in Coral Gables to have such great partnerships, friendships, and opportunities to collaborate. And I hope today was just another way for us to showcase that partnership. So feel free to turn on your mics for those that want to stick around for a few minutes. We'll leave it open for some chat. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.